Okay, let's find our new hymnals. Let's all stand and turn to 241. Let's all stand and sing Our Great Savior in our brand new church. Our brand new church. Sing it out, let's let it ring.
System makes noises at the very beginning. We're still figuring all of that out, and everything is not set exactly where it's going to be. Tonight's going to be just Let's just get used to the new building, okay? So all pressure is off, singers, all pressure is off, preacher, all pressure is off, participants, all pressure is off. Tonight's just getting used to the new building, all right? And so thank you again for being here and enjoying this time with us tonight. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you. And Father, we could never say, thank you enough for what you have done. We pray, oh God, that you would be honored and glorified in this building and in this time. We ask, oh God, that you would help us as we do adjust to a new building, that once again your name would be lifted up. And as we just sing, our great Savior, may you be honored. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
This song first, and then that may give you some chances to find your favorite song in the new book. 111, and can it be? 111, and can it be? Lift your voice, think about salvation. Think about what the Lord did for you. 111, and can it be?
Verse 1 and verse 3. 426, just a closer walk.
God will take care of you. Again, the first and the third, 158.
Thank you. because he lived. 387.
After this one, two more.
387, because he lives.
Thank you.
salvation and you think about heaven. These last two verses, lift your voice with a strong, strong choir. Think about the presence of the Lord. Verse number 3, verse number 4, and then we'll be seated and then we'll be done for this portion of the sermon. Verse number 3, ready?
My sin, O Lord, is glorious.
With our new surroundings, and everybody comfortable with the air conditioning?
Yeah.
it great to have air conditioning? And what about those chairs? And somebody was actually worried about the fact that we don't have a clock. You got air conditioning, you got comfortable chairs, what do you need a clock for? Don't worry, I won't go too long tonight, but I wanted to start off. You guys did a great job singing tonight. I just felt like it would be good to get in and just sing. Being in a bigger church, a bigger building, sometimes it takes a little bit to get used to it, but you guys lifted your voices up. I found even as I was standing out there in the front and greeting people, I was whispering. And I was like, what am I whispering for? I need to speak up. And so we're just kind of fitting in here. The pulpit is brand new. It was just delivered this afternoon at 3, about 4 o'clock this afternoon. So this is the first time I preached behind this pulpit. It's the first time I preached on a platform that is this size. And so we're getting used to everything. So I hope you're comfortable. And we're just going to kind of have family night tonight. This message tonight is for our church family. And I was thinking about moving into a new building, moving into a new place. And we got this on? Okay, so I can move around now. I'm moving around, all right? And I told him I'm going to have to practice my eye contact because it's a bigger suite now. But Daniel was in Daniel chapter number 6, had just moved to a new location. He had just taken on some new responsibilities. And there was a lot of new things that were going on in his life. And as I was reading this, I thought, this is exactly what we need on Sunday night as we move into our new auditorium. There are going to be some changes. There are going to be some things that are going to happen over the next few weeks. And as I, people have come up to me and asked me about different things, you know, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do this? And all of those things, we're thinking them out. We're working them out. We're kind of fleshing things out before we have our grand opening. As you can tell, landscaping hasn't been done yet. And the plastic, that's the EPA. That's not us. And so we're sorry for that look and all of that. And all that needs to be done. The fence needs to be put up. A lot of things that need to be done. Sunday school classrooms need to be built. School classrooms need to be built. All of that's future and one step at a time. But we need to kind of adjust to this new auditorium. And so I wanted to talk to you a little bit about Daniel and some things that happened to him when there was some new opportunities, some new changes that took place in his life. And so we're going to look at Daniel chapter number 6 in just a minute. We're going to stand and I'm going to read the passage of scripture and then sit down. We'll have our special and then I'll come back and preach it. But Daniel, one thing that I noticed about Daniel, the king here in this story is Darius, and Darius noticed one thing about Daniel, and that is that Daniel continued. The use of the word continue is all the way through this chapter, and Daniel, even though he had come to a new place, a new position, all of these new things took place, there was one thing he was known for. He just stayed by the stuff. He just continued. Some things will change, but some things need to stay the same. And we need to continue in some certain areas. And Daniel gives us these areas that we need to continue in. And so I'm going to talk to you about these new places, these new opportunities, and the way that Daniel continued to do what was right. If you would, stand with me, and I'll read verses 16 through 20 for our scripture reading tonight. Verses 16 through 20 of Daniel chapter number 6. The Bible says, "Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him to the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, Thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And the stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den. And the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went into his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. And when the king rose very early in the morning, and went in haste into the den of lions, and when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions?" Heavenly Father, once again, we come to you with a very, very grateful heart, thanking you, Lord, for all of the great things that you've done for us, and how can we not be thankful and grateful for what you've done? Lord, I ask that you'd work in our hearts tonight and help us to determine that we will continue to serve you. We pray these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Took them in captivity to Babylon. And Daniel was a young man. He was of the royal family, and he was taken as a special prize for the people of Babylon, and they trained him and disciplined him in the ways of the Chaldeans and the Babylonians, and trained him to be a counselor to the king. And because God blessed him, and because he was wise, and because he had an excellent spirit, he was promoted to the place where he was actually counseling the king of Babylon. And Daniel grew up in Babylon. The chapter number 5, Daniel is about 60 years old. So he started off as a young man leaving Jerusalem and going to Babylon and spent most of his life in Babylon. Belshazzar was the last of the Babylonian kings. He did not know Nebuchadnezzar. He did not know Nebuchadnezzar as well. Nebuchadnezzar was his grandfather. He did not know Daniel as well. And he began to live a riotous life. And one night he decided to have a party. And he was going to use the vessels that were taken from the temple, the holy vessels that belonged to God. And he put wine in them, alcoholic drink in them, and he began to drink and have this party. And while in the middle of the night, while they were having this party, a hand came out and wrote on the wall, and it wrote in a language that the king did not understand. And the scary thing about this was it was just a hand. You know, because of it or whatever, you know, it was just a hand. And it wrote on the wall, and it wrote in a language that the king did not understand. The Bible said that his knees smoked together, I imagine. He was afraid of what was happening. And he called in his counselors and asked them, what is it that this writing on the wall? And they said, we can't read it. And his mother came in. She said, there's a very wise man that works for your grandfather, Nebuchadnezzar. His name is Daniel. And Daniel could probably read this for you. And so Belshazzar calls Daniel in. And Daniel reads the writing on the wall. And basically it says, you are weighed in the balance and found wanting. In other words, God had judged him. And God had found him wanting. And Daniel said, tonight is the last night of the kingdom of Babylon. Babylon is going to be destroyed. You're the last king. And sure enough, just as God said, the Medo-Persians that very night came in. They were able to divert the water out of the moat that went around the city of Babylon. They were able to go in and destroy the city of Babylon, wipe out everybody that Daniel knew, everybody that Daniel had grown up with, everything that he was familiar with. The Medes took Daniel, and they took him captive. This is the second time in Daniel's life that he's taken captive. Once as a young man, and now as a 60-year-old, he is taken captive. He's taken out of Babylon, and he's taken to the Mede Empire and to the capital of the Mede Kingdom, where the king Darius is the king. And now he has moved from what he was familiar with to a brand new place. And many things happen in chapter number 6. We've gone from chapter number 5 now into chapter number 6. And many things have happened to Daniel. And Daniel's testimony is that he continued to serve the Lord. Even though things had changed, even though things were new, everything was not familiar with him, he hadn't found his place, which seat was his seat yet in the auditorium. He's still trying them all out to find out which angle is the right one. And he doesn't know how cold the pastor's going to have the air conditioner running, so he doesn't know whether to bring a sweater yet or not. And all these types of things. But Daniel said, no matter what the changes are, I'm going to continue to serve the Lord. And that's what I want for our church tonight. I believe that's what the Lord wants for our church. God has blessed us. God has given us this great auditorium. And there's much, like I said, much to do, much in the future, much that the Lord is going to bless us with, and I'm sure that He's going to. But we need to determine tonight that no matter what the Lord blesses us with, and no matter what changes come, good, bad, evil, blessings, whatever type of changes come, we're going to make a determination, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. Friendship is going to continue to serve the Lord. And that's what Daniel did. The first thing that I would like you to see about Daniel is Daniel went to a new place. He went to a new place, and he continued in a new place. Daniel, the Bible says that Daniel was taken here from the from the Babylonians to the Medo-Persians. And immediately, he began to endear himself to the new king. Now, again, the king had conquered the Babylonians. The Babylonians were the enemy. The Babylonians were the bad guys. But somehow Daniel was able to show himself that he was going to continue to do what's right and continue to be faithful. And because of that, the king took a liking to him. And he began to give him a place to serve in this new kingdom. And I want you to see what helped him to continue in this new place. Looking at Daniel chapter number 6. And it says in verse number 3, then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and the princes, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set over him the whole realm. Daniel, in this new place, was so faithful, and the reason he continued is because he had an excellent spirit. In a new place, we need to have an excellent spirit. We need to have a determination that we're going to continue to do the right thing, the good thing, the best thing. Now, again, there's changes that are taking place. We're going from two services to one service. Did you notice tonight that we had three song leaders? There's a reason we have three song leaders. We have so many services before, we had song leaders in each one of the services. It's going to be very easy for one of those song leaders to say, well, they don't need me anymore. Are you listening to me? We don't have a place for snacks. And we don't want you to bring snacks into the new building. Well, they don't need me anymore. No, we still need you. We need to, it may be a different task. There are new tasks that are going to be needed. We're going to have to keep this auditorium clean. You say, well, I'm not going to clean it up. Wait a minute. We're in a new place. We need to keep an excellent spirit. We need to keep a good spirit. Look at how many aisles we've got. We're going to need ushers. We're going to need greeters. There are going to be so many other things that are going to be happening. And by the way, you don't need to come up and say, Pastor, do you need me to... If you see it, do it. That is an excellent spirit. And that's what Daniel had. Daniel's excellent spirit here was not an excellent spirit necessarily in spiritual matters. That comes later. The excellent spirit that he had was, I'm just going to get the job done. I'm going to do what I need to do. If I see something that needs to be done, I'm going to do it. It makes me think of the man Joseph. Remember how Joseph was sold by his brothers into slavery? And before long, he was the steward of the master's house. Why? Because he had an excellent spirit. Not so much that he read his Bible and he prayed. Those are all things I'm going to talk about, so don't get worried of them, okay? But what he was talking about was he cleaned the floor. He made sure that the songbooks got put back in the racks. He watched the kids to make sure that they weren't running around in the auditorium and running their hands across the walls and putting their hands on the glass. And there's a lot of glass in this place. And there's going to be a lot of things for us to do. Let's keep an excellent spirit. Proverbs chapter number 3, verses 3 and 4. The Bible says, let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. God says, I want you to understand, you need to have a great spirit and a great attitude when you come to a new place. It's not going to be perfect. Have you already noticed the PA system squeaked a couple of times? The song leader's timing might not have just been perfect. The piano player was telling the song director what to do. It's not going to be perfect. And you know what? This side of heaven, nothing's going to be perfect. But our attitude can always be an excellent attitude, a right spirit, and a right attitude. Let's be flexible with one another. Let's be forgiving with one another. Let's serve one another. Daniel had an excellent spirit when he was in a new place. Now, the next thing I want you to see is not only was he in a new place and had new opportunities, but he got a new promotion. A new promotion. Here's Daniel. He came in as a captive from Israel. He was brought in, and he was brought into Babylon. He worked his way up, all the way up to where he was the advisor to the king, one of the most powerful men in the Babylonian kingdom. He told the king what to think. Pretty powerful person. And then all of a sudden, it comes crashing down.
The Medes and Persians come in and they wipe out the city and they take Daniel captive. He's 60 years old. He's going into captivity. He's coming to this new place, this new capital, the place of the Medes and the Persians. And he has an excellent spirit. And King Darius sees him and says, "All right, I'm going to have to reorganize this thing. We're going to have to do things a little bit different here." And he takes and he divides the kingdom up into 120 provinces. And he puts a man in charge of each one of these provinces. Darius was known for delegating authority. And he delegated. He said, "Now you do this, you take care of this, you take care of this, you take care of this responsibility." And somehow Daniel got into all of this. This captive from Babylon, Darius thought, "Man, this guy knows how to take care of the bathrooms. He knows how to take care of the floor. He knows how to, as a 6-year-old man, he's still picking up trash and he's still doing the things that he needs to be doing. I think I'll put him in charge of a providence." And before long, he got promoted to being one of the three princes that was over the 120 leaders or governors of the 120 providences. And now Daniel is getting to the place where the king is looking at him and saying, "Now I'm going to put him as my regent, my prime minister. I'm going to put him over the three presidents." Daniel got a promotion. I don't know about you, but I feel like we got promoted tonight. When we sing "Higher Ground," this is it. This, the Lord has got us to higher ground. And God will promote, God will bless, and God will give us opportunities to do more for God. But let me just tell you, a promotion is a promotion in service. Often what happens is when we get a promotion, we think it's a title. And we think it's an opportunity for me to walk around and say, "I'm the prime minister. I'm one of the three top presidents. I'm the advisor to the king. You ought to respect me and honor me." And by the way, that's the way the Medes and Persians ran things. If you were a leader, you were considered a god. But Daniel wasn't that way. And the Bible tells us in Daniel chapter number 6 and verse number 10. "Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into the house, and his windows being opened in the chambers towards Jerusalem, he kneeled down upon his knees 3 times in a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime." Daniel said, "You know what? I'm just going to keep on praying. I'm going to keep on thanking God. Tonight, we're very grateful for what God has done. There's going to come a time where we're going to put some more sweat equity into this property. Then we're going to have to put some grass in. We're going to have to put some..." And it's going to be very easy to say, "Oh, I can't believe we've got to do all this work. Why did Pastor hire this stuff out?" Because we need to make it ours. And we need to continue to pray and trust the Lord and to thank God for what He's done. In every situation. Now, we're going to talk about this situation where this verse is. But things are starting to get bad for Daniel. And yet Daniel begins and continues to thank God. He begins and he continues to worship God. With the promotions, the ups and the downs of life, with all that happens, he continues to pray. Don't stop being thankful. Continue to be thankful. Continue to serve the Lord when the things are great and you have a consistent walk with God. Keep praying. How many prayers have we had? How many times have we had a prayer meeting? How many times have we come to this building and those walls that were in the back? We wrote prayer requests on those walls and we stood here and prayed. The other day when we brought the chairs in and set the chairs up, we prayed. When we arranged the chairs and cleaned the floors, and we prayed. We've had so many times, but now we're in. God is blessed. God has answered prayers. Don't stop praying. Don't stop praying. Don't give up. Continue to pray. Continue to ask. There's so much more I believe that God wants to do. John R. Rice tells a story of sleeping one night that he died and he went to heaven. And he was walking down the streets of heaven and Jesus was giving him a tour of heaven. And he was showing him all of the things of heaven. He was showing him the streets of gold and the mansions and and all of the great things that were going on in heaven. He listened to the angel choir for a while and saw the river of life and the trees of life that were growing on both sides and the 12 different types of fruit and all of the great things about heaven. And they walked by this great big warehouse. John Rice looked at Jesus and said, "What's that?" And Jesus said, "No, you don't want to go over there. You don't want to know about that." And he said, "Yeah, I want to know everything about heaven." He said, "I want to enjoy everything about heaven. I want to know what's in there." He said, "Oh, that's just a warehouse." And John Rice said, "No, let me see what's in there." So Jesus took him over and opened up the door. And inside were packages, just full of the whole place, from the floor to the ceiling was filled with packages. John Rice turned and looked at Jesus. Now, this is a dream. This is just a story. But he turned to Jesus and he looked at him and he said, "What's all this?" And Jesus said, "These are all the prayer requests that I had for you that you never prayed. All the answers to prayer that I had for you. All the things I had ready to give you and you never asked for them." Wouldn't that be a sad situation to get to heaven and see all of the things that God says, "I have them for you. I want you to have these. I wanted to give you victory in your family. I wanted to give you victory in your home. I wanted you to have a great service in church. I wanted you to see numbers of souls saved. I wanted you to see these great things." But you never asked. You never asked. Daniel said, "I'm going to keep on praying. Man, when I get a promotion, I'm going to keep on praying. When I get a new job, when I get a raise on the new job, I'm going to be thankful to God. I'm going to praise Him. And I'm going to keep on asking. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. We've got to continue. We've got to continue." So we continue even in a new promotion. Continue to serve God. 1 Thessalonians 5, 17 and 18. The Bible says, "Pray without ceasing." Thank you. "In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." You want to know what God's will is for your life? Prayer and thanksgiving. Prayer and thanksgiving. I can tell you right now, that's what some of you young men are trying to figure out what to do with your life. I know two things that God wants you to do with your life. He wants you to pray and He wants you to get to be thankful. Continue to do that. Continue to do that. Continue to watch what God is going to do. Don't let the promotion make you stop praying and praising God. Continue praying, and you never know when you'll need God. Now, God answers 911 prayers. He does. "God, I've got to have you right now." And God answers those prayers. But I sure would like to be able to know that when I call on God, that He's heard my voice, He recognizes my voice, and He's ready to answer. And He doesn't say, "Now, we got to work on this prayer thing." Or, "Hey, I haven't heard that voice in a while. Maybe I'll let Him suffer for a little while and He'll call on me some more and I'll hear Him." I want God to hear me plenty of times so He doesn't have to get my attention. And so let's continue to pray. Let's keep on praying. Continue to have communion with God. This building is not about our comfort. This building is about our communion with God. Just a closer walk with Thee is what we sang tonight. I hope those weren't just words to you. I hope that that's the true desire of your heart. Just a closer walk with Thee. And so Daniel continued in a new place. He continued in a new promotion. Then third of all, he continued in a new persecution. He continued in a new persecution. Most of you know the story of Daniel chapter number 6. When this promotion came, Daniel was promoted, and the king was thinking about promoting him even higher, to a higher promotion. And the other princes, the other leaders, they began to get jealous. And let me just say, there will be people that will be jealous. Don't let that rob your joy. Don't let that rob your joy of what God is doing in your life. And troubles are going to come. Troubles are going to come. Don't think that just because we got in the new building, all of our problems have ceased. It hasn't. Daniel here has gone from a new location to a new prince to a new promotion, and now some trouble comes. These princes get jealous of him, and they go to Darius and they ask him, they say, "Darius, now we want to prove the loyalty of these new Chaldeans and Babylonians that you brought into the kingdom. We want to make sure that they're loyal to you. And so here we want to make a law. And the why is that nobody can pray, nobody can ask a request of any God unless, that until they come and ask you. They've got to talk to you. That's the only request, that's the only prayer that can be made. Now Darius was one of those guys that had a big head. And he thought, that is a good idea. I get treated as God. And again, the Medes and the Persians and the Babylonians and the Egyptians and the Romans and all the rest of them and some Americans think that they're God. And so he was ready to sign this. One thing I missed on this, and I want to go back to it. When these men were looking at Daniel, and they said, we got to get Daniel. We got to get Daniel. They first tried to find something that he was doing wrong at work. They went to his job and they said, we're going to find out, you know, he's stealing stuff. He's doing something wrong. He's cutting corners somewhere. Nobody can be that good. And I love this. The Bible says they couldn't find anything. They couldn't find anything. Now, I'm just going to ask you, Christians and friendship people, I'm just going to ask you, if we did an investigation, how would you like to have somebody do an investigation to see if they could find something on you? Wouldn't it be great to have a testimony they couldn't find anything? That's the kind of life that Daniel lived, and that's what he continued to do. That's that excellent spirit that he had. But Daniel, they said, we can't find anything on him, so the only thing that we can get him on is on his service to God, his love for God. Wouldn't it be great if your enemies, the only thing they could find on you is that you love God, that you serve God, that you were faithful? That's the kind of testimony that Daniel had. They talked the king into signing this decree. And the king signed the decree. And the decree went out around the kingdom. As soon as Daniel heard it, Daniel went to his room, went to his house. He went to a window. And now the Jewish people always prayed towards Jerusalem. Similar to what they do today, they have the Wailing Wall, and they're standing towards that's as close to the temple as they can get. And so they always prayed towards the temple. The temple represented the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't pray in a certain direction. We pray up, because that's where Christ is, or we pray from our hearts, because that's where Christ is, and we pray to the Lord Jesus Christ. But Daniel prayed towards the temple, because that represented God, that represented the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he wasn't showing off, and he wasn't daring anybody. This was his regular, normal habit. He bowed before a window, facing towards Jerusalem, and he began by thanking God for the good things that he's done. He had heard that the decree was coming. He had heard that he would be thrown in the lion's den if he prayed to God. But he said, I've got to pray to God. I can't go a month without praying to God. I can't go a month without talking to God. I've just got to keep up the habit that I have. You know, someday there may come persecution, real persecution to our country. And they may be looking for Christians. And I've asked this question before. If it became illegal to become a Christian, or be a Christian, would there be enough evidence to find you guilty? It's not like all of a sudden when the persecution comes, all of a sudden we're going to stand for Christ. No, you need to be standing for Christ all along. And Daniel was standing for Christ all along. And he continued to do what was right, even when the problems and the persecution came. Looking at Daniel chapter number 6 and verse number 16. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. The men saw Daniel praying, and they came to the king and they said, hey, king, didn't you sign a decree that no one could pray to anybody but you? And the king said, that's right, by the means of the Persians. That means it was legally, you could not change it. That was intended to keep the kings from making arbitrary laws, which Darius had just done. Darius said, it's by the laws of the Medes and Persians that cannot be changed. And they said, well, we just saw Daniel over there praying. And Darius went, oh, I forgot about Daniel. I forgot Daniel was a man that continued to do what is right. He had an excellent spirit who prayed and thanked God and did what was right. And he says, I've got to figure a way to get him out of here. And he tried. He called the lawyers in. He called the CLA on the phone and the Christian Law Association. He called the local lawyer. And he did all of these things and tried to get there to help him to get Daniel out. And they could not get Daniel out. And so the law was that Daniel had to go into the lion's den. And they took Daniel and they cast him in the lion's den. They rolled a stone over the mouth of the den and they sealed it with a signet. I think that's a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ when they buried him and put him in the tomb and sealed the tomb. He was as good as dead. And the king stands at the mouth and looks down in the lion's den and says, oh Daniel, I like this, the Bible says, with a lamentable voice. He says, oh Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. Now, I'm not sure, but I think maybe there was a question mark there. I think what he was saying was, will he deliver thee? I know you serve him continually, but I'm hoping that he'll... You say, how do you know that? Because he goes back to his house and he says, I don't want to eat anything. I don't want to listen to any music. I'm not going to sleep tonight. I'm going to fast. I'm hoping that God will deliver him. But I love the fact that the king knew that Daniel continued to serve him. Even when it was hard, even when it was difficult, even when the persecution came, when he was attacked by the princes, he kept on serving God. Don't think that just because you have good things happen to you, that your problems have ceased. Jesus says to us in John chapter 16, verse number 33, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. God says, you're going to have trouble. In fact, in another place in John, he says, don't be surprised. Hey, Christian, don't be surprised when the tough times come. We think that we're in a new auditorium, everything's going to be great. I'm telling you, everything is great, but there's going to be trouble. There's going to be persecution. Don't be surprised. Don't say, well, I thought we had a new auditorium. I thought all of our problems were over. No, they're not over. Not till we get to heaven. But that's the thing that we've got. Jesus has overcome. Amen. He is overcome. And so we can keep on going. We can continue to serve him. Quitters never win. And winners never quit. Don't give up. Don't get discouraged. Don't give in. Keep on going. That one more step. That one more obstacle. That one more hill that we crest, that one more giant that we slay, that one more Jericho wall that we walk around and the walls come tumbling down. One more step, one more time around, just one more time. Keep on going. Don't quit. Don't give in. Continue to serve the Lord. In the times of troubles and perils and trials, keep on serving God. Daniel served him even in the new persecution. And then the next thing that we see about Daniel, Daniel continued in the new preservation. In the new preservation. The Bible says that old king went to his house and they came out with the musicians to play him to sleep that night. And he said, turn the music off. I don't want to hear any music. I'm worried about Daniel. And he wouldn't eat that night. They didn't have no dinner that night. Everybody was quiet. They hung black drapes from the windows and everybody was worried about Daniel. And all night long, the old king paced back and forth. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what Daniel did, but we know that Daniel was delivered. We know that Daniel, the next morning, calls out and says the angel came and closed the mouth of the lion. Now, I'm sure when he first dropped down in there, he was a little concerned. Just think about being dropped down into a bunch of hungry lions. And I think he's standing there, and I think those lions started to crawl up next to him and get ready to eat him. And they got their claws out, they got their fangs out, and they got ready to eat old Daniel. And just as they got ready to swipe him with that old claw, something stopped it. And the lion looked over there, and there was an angel hanging onto that claw. And the lion said, well, I'll get him with this claw. Angel over here. I'll get him with my mouth. And the angel just pulled. And Daniel's sitting there watching. I don't know if Daniel saw the angels or not, but all he saw was the lion's going. The king was up pacing all night long. Daniel, as far as we know, he went to sleep. He slept with those lions that night. But early the next morning, as soon as the sun came up, Daniel's parole was coming his way. And the king comes running in verse number 23. He says, then was the king exceeding glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den and no manner of hurt was found on him. Now look at the next phrase. Because he believed in his God. What does God want you to do? God wants you to keep on serving Him. He wants you to keep on praying. He wants you to keep on worshiping Him. He wants you to keep on going and don't get discouraged and quit and give up. And He wants you to keep on believing God. Keep on trusting God. Look, this place was built by faith. It was built by faith of faithful people that put their faith in God. God built this place. It's to His honor and to His glory. Again, thank you so much for everyone that came in and said, Pastor, it looks great, and you did an awesome job. I didn't do an awesome job. God did an awesome job. And we need to continue to trust Him and rely on Him. We need to fill this place up. I'm excited about the number of people that's in here tonight. I'm thinking, how did we do this in that little auditorium we had before? And to be sitting up on the platform and having all the windows and seeing all of you guys running off Hawaiian time. Coming in late. And I'm like, this is great. There's more people coming. But there's still empty seats. God doesn't just want a building. God wants people. And God says, you need to trust. You need to depend. You need to believe. Look, there are certain things that we believe in Friendship. We still believe them. The new building is not going to change what we believe. We're going to continue to be faithful and to trust in the Lord and to believe what the Lord says. Daniel believed in God. He kept his faith. He kept his testimony. Because he believed in God, he kept trusting in Him. And the world began to understand what Daniel believed. It's not enough to be able to say it. You need to show it. What do you actually believe in? In Psalm chapter number 37, verse number 39, but salvation of the righteous is of the Lord. He is their strength in time of trouble. The Lord shall help them and deliver them. He shall deliver them from the wicked and save them because they trust in Him. Keep on believing. Keep on trusting. Don't let the situation shake your faith. By the way, good things can shake your faith. When good things are happening, when you move into a new building, when you got the air conditioning and the padded chairs, it can start to shake your faith. You say, how can I do that? You start thinking, I deserve this. I deserve this. Well, I signed the equipment card at the building banquet. I deserve this. No, you don't deserve that. I don't deserve any of this. God is the one that deserves all the honor and all the glory. And so we're going to praise Him. Continue to trust in Jesus. Continue to believe the truth. Continue until deliverance comes. Look, sometimes it looks so tough. It looks so bad. You're in the lion's den. The lion's creeping up there. He's got his claws out. He's got his fangs out. He's just about ready to get you. Keep on trusting God. Keep on believing God. There were so many times when I thought, man, God, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? Why? It's so easy for us to just stay at the old building and just kind of coast on through. And God says, I want you to keep on going. I want you to take that challenge. I want you to believe me. I told the church the other day, when we get into this building, it's going to be like David slaying Goliath. I mean, it's going to be awesome. And God puts those giants in our ways. God puts the lion dens in our ways. And he says, now will you trust me? Trust me in the good, will you trust me in the bad? And trust me in the bad, will you trust me in the good? Keep on trusting. Keep on believing. Keep your faith. Daniel continued to believe in God. They delivered Daniel. They brought him out of the lion's den. The Bible says that they took those men that had accused him and come up with this crazy law, and they took him and their families and they threw him in the lion's den. And the Bible says before they even touched the ground, the lions ate them up. So we know that it wasn't just that the lions weren't hungry. They destroyed these men. And then Darius the king promoted Daniel. And the Bible actually uses this word. He prospered. He prospered. And I love this. I love this about Daniel's testimony. Everywhere Daniel went, people turned to the Lord. Nebuchadnezzar, I believe Nebuchadnezzar got saved. The king of Babylon, I believe he got saved. If you read Daniel chapter number 4, that's a gospel tract that Nebuchadnezzar gave. He said, I want my testimony to go out to people so they know how I came to know the Lord. It was a gospel tract for people to get saved. Daniel is the one, I believe, that led Nebuchadnezzar to the Lord. Now, Darius, I don't know that he got saved. But he did something amazing here. He goes, I want everybody to know about Daniel's God. I want everybody to know about Daniel's God. Looking at verse number 28. And so this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius, the reign of Cyrus the Persian. He gave out this declaration to the kingdom. He says, I want you to worship the God that Daniel serves continually. Daniel's testimony made a difference in the community that he lived in. It made a difference in the job place that he worked at. It made a difference in the church that he attended. It made a difference in the testimony, his life. His life spoke volumes to those that were around him. And the Bible says that because of that, many people came to know the Lord and he prospered. Daniel prospered. Now again, I don't know that Daniel prospered financially. He may have. Being an advisor to the king's probably a pretty good gig. Probably pays pretty good. But I don't know that that's what God is talking about here. God is talking to Daniel and he's saying to Daniel, I want to prosper you. I think Daniel saw many people saved. And notice what it says. He lived all the way till the time of Cyrus the Persian. Do you know that Cyrus the Persian was the very next king? We have the Babylonians destroyed by the Medo-Persians. The Medes came in and were kings. And then the Persians came in and were kings. Do you know Daniel was nearly 100 years old before he died? Do you know what's special about Cyrus? Cyrus is the king that allowed the Jews to go back to Jerusalem. It was the end of captivity. Daniel lived all the way through the captivity. God prospered him. Why? Because he continued in new prosperity. He kept his testimony. He kept his testimony. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter number 12, verse 8, but also I say unto you, whosoever shall confess me before men, him shall the Son of Man also confess before the angels of God. But he that denieth me before men shall also deny before the angels of God. Be faithful in your service, in your testimony. It speaks to the lost. There are some people that will never pick up a Bible and read it. They'll never come to church and hear a preacher. The only Bible they'll ever see or read is your life. The only sermon they'll ever hear is your life. What kind of a testimony do you have? Friendship, we need to guard our testimony. We need to continue to keep our testimony right. We need to establish one. Establish a testimony. I think after 30 years, friendship has a testimony. Let's continue to work on that testimony. And again, it's not an organization, it's people. You make up friendship. You are the testimony. Testing establishes it. Let's profess God. Let's talk to others about God. One of the things that friendship is known about is soul winning. We're one of the churches that goes out, knocks on doors, and invites people to church and tells people the gospel. Let's keep that testimony. What, we got a great big building that's sitting right on the corner. It's right across from the Safeway and the Ross and City Mill. People drive by it all the time. Just put a great big sign out in the front, put lights on it, people will come. No. It's still me. Hello, we're from the Friendship Baptist Church. We'd like to invite you to church. If you die today, you know for sure you go to heaven when you die. Let's keep that testimony. Let's keep going. Let's keep doing it. Let's continue. In a new place, let's continue to do right. Let's continue to do right. With a new promotion, let's continue to pray and be thankful. With new persecution, let's continue without discouragement. Don't quit. Don't give up. With new perseverance or preservation, continue to believe. Keep your faith. And in new prosperity, continue to testify and keep the profession. Heavenly Father, we come to you. We thank you again for this first night in our auditorium. But Lord, more importantly, we ask, Lord, in our lives, that you would help us to continue. Help us to have a testimony. Help us to make a difference in Eva. Help us to make a difference in Hawaii. Lord, help us make a difference around the world. Help us, oh God, to be like Daniel, to determine that we're going to continue in a new place, new promotion, new persecution, new preservation, and new prosperity. Oh God, help us to continue. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. No one's looking.